Today, I would ask a very important question to all of us. Why Jesus? Why not Mary? Why not Muhammad? Why not modern religion? Why Jesus? Why do we celebrate his birth? Why do we celebrate his life? Why do we believe he rose from the dead? And why do we believe he is the only way and the only one by which we can have life with God? Why not Mary? Why not Muhammad? Why not other modern religions? Well, today we're going to discuss that. And I know that some of you are going, oh, Pastor Andrew, I already know all this. You do? And maybe you do. Maybe you don't. If you do know, well, I'm hoping that you're going to be able to learn some more things today through the scriptures that you can share with others who don't know. Why? Because today's big theme is this. No Jesus, no salvation. But if you know Jesus and have a personal relationship with him, then you know what? Salvation. Amen on that? Good. Let's open our Bibles, please. We're going to go to, wow, I'm not used to this, New Testament, okay? I'm hoping that you guys will understand a little bit more since we've been in the Old Testament for a while. Luke chapter 1, okay? I got some bad news for everybody. Oh, by the way, fill in the blanks there in South Florida if you want to pass them out, pens and paper, pencils. Yosef, give me that real quick and a pen, please. Okay, I got some bad news for everybody, okay? I'm not going to put the scriptures I'm using today on the screen. That means you're going to have to actually read the Bible yourself. Yeah. I'll give you a little hint. We're going to go to three main passages today. Luke 1. Well, three main books. Luke, John, and Hebrews, okay? So here's what I want everybody here or there to have in their hands. I want you to have a Bible. I want you to have the fill-ins. And I want you to have a pen, and I want you to get nice and comfortable, and I want you to get ready to dig deep into the scriptures. Because again, no Jesus, no salvation. But if you know Jesus, then you know that you know you have salvation. Okay? So let's start out in Luke chapter 1, a very familiar passage starting in verse 26, and we're going to dig into this, okay? In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, who was Elizabeth? She was married to a priest by the name of Zachariah. Okay? They were going to eventually become the parents of John the Baptist. Now, we're told that she was 6 months pregnant with John the Baptist. God sent the angel, underline that word, angel Gabriel to Nazareth. Yes, it's legal to underline your Bibles, okay? Sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin, I would underline that word also, pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, who was a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. So we see two main characters so far. We see the angel and we see Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored." Full of grace is what it means in the original language. Greetings, you who are full of grace. The Lord is with you. Those Catholics, remember, Hail Mary, full of grace. The Lord is with you. Oh, you see where that came from? Yeah. Mary was greatly troubled at his words. I mean, can you imagine an angel showing up? And she wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Don't be afraid, Mary. For you have found favor with God." Again, you're full of grace. "You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him," what? Jesus. So I'd underline that word too. So we see angel, Mary, and Jesus. "He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants." Actually, the word in the original means house. "Over Jacob's house forever, and his kingdom will never end." Well, how will this be, Mary asked the angel, since I am a what? Virgin. Now watch, a lot of people think Mary was doubting here. I don't believe she was doubting here. I think she was just going, okay, I'm going to be pregnant. That's good, but I'm a virgin. And I believe she was just asking, how's this going to happen? Not doubting, based upon the angel's response. The angel answered. He didn't yell at her, rebuke her, like he had done earlier to Zechariah, who had doubted. Instead, he said, the Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Do me a favor, underline Holy One. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age. And she, who was said to be unable to conceive, is already pregnant in her sixth month. For no word from God, I love this, will ever fail. And look at Mary's response. She said, I am the Lord's what? Servant. Underline that word. May your word be fulfilled. Then the angel left her. I love that. She didn't quite understand. I mean, supernatural pregnancy, Holy Spirit, all this stuff. And I love her answer. I'm the Lord's servant. May your word be fulfilled. Now, we saw three people in this passage, right? We saw the angel. What was his name? Gabriel. We saw Mary. And we saw Jesus. Or at least their reference to Jesus. So in this passage here, I have a question. Why Jesus? Why? I mean, the angel seemed like a pretty big deal, right? In this passage, he came and spoke to Mary. Mary seems like a pretty big deal in this passage, I would think. Wouldn't you agree? Full of grace. So I guess as we now start to dissect this, let's ask the first question. Why Jesus and why not Mary? I mean, after all, based upon what we just read, you want to know something? There's a doctrine in the Catholic religion called the Immaculate Conception. Yeah, in 1854, there was a pope by the name of Pope Pius who declared, based upon what we just read, that Mary did not have original what? Sin. She was immaculately conceived, full of grace. Hail Mary, full of grace. The Lord is with you. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners. For those of us who had grown up in the Catholic Church. Isn't it amazing how we still remember that stuff? Yeah, the Pope said, let me break it down. This announcement by the angel 2,000 years ago is called the Annunciation. It is a holiday in a Catholic religion. I think it's around March or April of each year. And basically, it celebrates the fact that the angel made this announcement to Mary. Make sense? Now, in 1950, another pope declared something new about Mary. The day of Assumption. That Mary ascended into heaven, she never died. Why? Well, the Annunciation, she was highly favored, full of grace, 2,000 years ago. 1854, it was declared she was without what? Sin. She's perfect. Therefore, no sin, no what? Death. 1950, this was declared. And Catholics throughout the world on August 14th of every year celebrate that. The Assumption of Mary. Here it's called Velika Gospa. Okay? Now, you can understand based upon what the Pope decreed. By the way, this Pope wasn't the first one in the Catholic religion who said that. Actually, you can go back to the 1550s, the Council of Trent, where it was also declared that Mary is sinless. She's perfect. Now, with that in mind, look at verse 39. At that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home. Who was Zechariah? Husband of Elizabeth. And she greeted Elizabeth, who was her cousin. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, what did the baby do? Leaped in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you." Who was she talking to? Mary. "Among women, and blessed is the child you will bear." Blessed are you, Mary, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Remember that was said also in the Catholic Church? "But why am I so favored," Elizabeth asked, "that the mother of my Lord should come to me? Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners. As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears," whose greeting? Mary's greeting. "The baby in my womb leaped for joy. Blessed is she who has believed that the Lord would fulfill his promises to her." So again, I ask the question, why Jesus and why not Mary? I mean, obviously, if Mary was sinless, if Mary is the mother of God who can pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death, amen, why not Mary? I mean, we see what the Catholic Church says. We see that over a billion people are in this movement and do worship and pray to Mary. Why Jesus and why not Mary? Well, let's see what Mary had to say. Verse 46. "And Mary said," this is after Elizabeth said, "Wow, it's so great that you're in my home. And the John the Baptist, 6 months in the mother's womb, leaped for joy when he heard the sound of Mary." Mary said, this is her song, it's called the Magnificat. "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my what?" Oh, who needs a savior? Sinners. You want to fill in the blanks? Real quick, Mary realized that she needed a what? Savior. Because Mary, number two, acknowledged that she is a what? Sinner. Let's go further. "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God, my Savior," meaning she had a relationship with the Lord. "For he has been mindful of the humble state of his what? Servant." Fill in the blank. Mary not only realized that she needed a Savior, she not only realized she was a sinner, Mary declared that she is the Lord's what? Slave. In the original language, the word servant means bond slave. Just look over back where we were, we read a little bit earlier, where she said in verse 38, "I am the Lord's what? Servant, bond slave." A bond slave is here or here? Yes. So Mary tells us something about her. We have the question, why Jesus, why not Mary? Well, Mary goes, I need a savior because I'm a sinner. I know what was declared by these different popes, but it's not the truth. In fact, I'm not somebody to be worshipped. I'm a bond slave. "From now on, all generations will call me blessed." That is true. "For the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is," huh? his name, not my name, she didn't say. In fact, it's very interesting. Holy is his name. Remember a little earlier we read at the end of verse 35? So the Holy One to be born, the angel said, will be called the Son of God. Holy is his name, not my name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He, meaning God, has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel. Why? Because he was going to provide the promised Messiah. Remembering to be merciful to Abraham. Remember, the promise was coming through Abraham's line and to his descendants forever, just as he promised our ancestors. And after that, we're told Mary stayed with Elizabeth another 3 months and then returned home, pregnated by the Holy Spirit. And Joseph's going, "What happened, Mary?" That's a different story. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with you. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 2. For there is one God, do we agree with that? And there is only one mediator between God and man. Who is that? The man Christ Jesus. It's very interesting. The man, Christ Jesus. Christ meaning Messiah, Holy One, God. Man, who took on flesh. Jesus, which means Savior. So those three words, man, Christ, Jesus, tell us all we need to know about Jesus. God who became man, who came to save his people from sin. And why Jesus? Because he's the one who gave himself on that cross as a ransom for all kinds of people. Not just the Jews, Gentiles, his chosen people. Does that make sense? So, if people are praying to Mary, their prayers are not going to get past the ceiling. Because Mary, or Peter, or Paul, Peter, Paul, and Mary. That was a nice group in the 60s. You guys are too young here. Over there, they'll know that, yeah? Yeah. You can pray to Mary all you want. She's not the mediator. Like you and like me, she recognized she needed a Savior. She recognized she was a sinner, and she called herself, she was the Lord's bond slave. That's a Christian. We don't pray to Mary, we don't pray to Peter, we don't pray to Paul, we don't pray to Andrew, we don't pray to the priest, we don't pray to each other. We pray to and through the one and only mediator between God and man. That is the man, Christ Jesus. Why him? Because he's the only one who went to that cross to pay through his body and his blood a ransom for our souls. So why Jesus and why not Mary? You know why not Mary? Because Mary told us, not me. Does that make sense? Now, do we respect Mary? Obviously. Do we believe that, you know, a lot of times we get accused as Protestants. Well, you guys don't believe in Mary. How can I not believe in Mary when it's written right here? Of course I believe in Mary. I don't worship Mary. Why? Because Mary said, don't worship me. Why? She's like you and me. She was chosen for a very special calling, like you are, Christian, as well. So why Jesus? Why not Mary? Because Mary tells us. Does that make sense? Good. Did you guys learn something? We're going to come back to Luke in a little bit, but instead, let's just take a quick break and let's go, why Jesus and why not Muhammad? Okay? I'm not talking about Muhammad Ali here, okay? You guys know who Muhammad was, right? A little over 500 years after Christ. Okay? 500, 600 years after Christ, Muhammad, the story goes, was in a cave. He was actually having what people believe to be some sort of epileptic fit. And through this fit, foaming at the mouth, suddenly an angel showed up to him. Sound like anybody else? You know what the angel's name was? Gabriel. Sound like somebody else? And the angel Gabriel supposedly told Muhammad, Muhammad, forget all these other religions, Judaism, Christianity, and so forth. Muhammad, God, Allah, has sent me to you to give you the one and only religion. And what's that religion called? Islam. Now, what does Islam believe about God? First of all, Islam believes there's one God, one person. God is named Allah, and there's one God, one. They do not believe in the Trinity. And as a result, anybody, they say, who puts anything or anybody next to Allah, that's called a major violation of Islam. It's called shirk. They believe Christians commit shirk because we believe in the Holy Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. We believe in one God, three persons, right? God, one in being in his essence, but he's tri-personal, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. They believe we are committing shirk against Allah, and the punishment is death. And I don't have to tell you what's happening right now to Christians who are standing up and declaring and proclaiming the one true living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And you see these radical Muslim groups, I'm not saying all Muslims do it, radical groups cutting their heads off and now doing on video. Islam actually means submission to Allah. That's what Islam means. And the goal of Islam is to spread that religion, the rule and reign of Allah throughout the world. And you see the various different ways they do it. Some of it's through literature, Quran. Other ways, it's through various different propaganda. Other ways, it's through persecution, terrorism. But what does Islam believe about Jesus? Muhammad, the Quran, says that Jesus exists, but he's not God, nor is God Jesus. Islam, per Muhammad, says that Jesus was one of 124,000 prophets, like Moses, like Abraham. They believe in all that. In fact, Jesus was one of the best prophets, but not the best. Muhammad is the full and final prophet. That's why Muslims always declare in their language, we believe in Allah and his prophet Muhammad. And if anybody makes fun of Muhammad, like a couple years ago, I think it was in your country, they drew some cartoons or something, or maybe it was Belgium, about Muhammad. You saw what happened there. Okay? They interestingly believe Jesus was sinless. They believe that he was born of a virgin. They believe in Mary. But they believe that Jesus was created. Like Adam was created out of dust, Jesus was created out of the Virgin Mary. Make sense? Created. He's a created being. So this is what Muhammad taught. And at first, he tried to do it through literature. That didn't work so well. A couple years later, he brought the sword. He said, you want to start believing me now? Yeah. So, we know what Muhammad has to say about Jesus, right? Can we see what Jesus has to say about Jesus? Go to John chapter 6. And we're gonna zip through John here, okay? I'm going to give you some verses. Look at John chapter 6, verse 35. Then Jesus declared, I am, underline those two words, I am the bread of life. Like God provided manna from heaven in the Old Testament, Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. That's a pretty bold statement, right? But he keeps going on. Go over to chapter 8. Look at verse 12. When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am, underline those two words, the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness. That's a bold statement, right? Jesus is saying the world is full of darkness. You follow him, he says, you will have the light of life. Can you imagine Jesus making those statements in front of the religious leaders, how they reacted? We don't have to imagine. Go over to, a little bit to chapter 8, look at verse 48. The Jews answered him, aren't we right in saying that you are a what? Samaritan and demon-possessed. You know what they were saying? They were making fun of Jesus and the supposed virgin birth. They were saying Jesus was worse than a half-breed because his mother got impregnated, oh yeah, by the Holy Spirit. You are a bastard child. That's what they were saying. He says, you're a Samaritan and demon-possessed. Jesus said, I'm not possessed by a demon, but I honor my Father and you dishonor me. I am not seeking glory for myself, but there is one who seeks it, and he's the judge. Very truly, I tell you, whoever obeys my word will never see what? Death. At this they said, now we know you're demon-possessed. Abraham died. Abraham lived 2,000 years before Christ. And so did the prophets. Yet you say that whoever obeys your word will never taste death? Are you greater than our father Abraham? He died and so did the prophets. Who do you think you are? And Jesus says, let me tell you who I am. He replied, if I glorify myself, my glory means nothing. My Father, whom you claim as your God, just like the Muslims say we all worship the same God, who you claim as your God is the one who glorifies me. Though you don't know him, I know him. If I said I did not, I would be a liar like you. Jesus was not into making a lot of friends, was he? But I do know him and obey his word. Your father Abraham rejoiced at the thought of seeing my day. He saw it and was glad. They said, wait a second. You're not even 50 years old and you've seen Abraham. And here we go. Jesus is about to tell them who he is. Very truly I say to you, before Abraham was born, what are those two words? I am. At this, they picked up stones to stone him. But Jesus slipped away to the temple grounds. Fill in the blanks. Do you know what Jesus was saying there? First of all, in the original language, I am, the word is, it's translated ego, a me. And it's so powerful what he's saying there. Write it down. Jesus clearly said, I am the one who was, who is, and who will always be. He was quoting the same exact words from Exodus 3:14. Remember when Moses came to the burning bush? God said, you're going to go set my people free. And Moses says, who shall I say sent me? He said, tell them I am who I am. And the Jews clearly understood, ego me, I am. They clearly understood what Jesus was saying. Jesus was saying, fill it in. He clearly pointed to his self-existence. He was not created. And he is self-sustaining. He's not reliant on anyone or anything. And his eternality. In other words, he has always been and will always be. Do you know what Jesus was saying? Write it down. I'm God. And that's why they picked up stones to try to kill him, because they thought he was committing blasphemy. Do you see what Jesus was saying there? Now, interesting. Islam says Jesus is God? No. Muhammad said, no, the best he is a prophet. Make sense? Sinless. We'll get to that in a second. Well, okay, this is great. Jesus, whew, okay, he almost got killed and he made a couple, I am, I'm the bread of life, I'm the light of the world, before Abraham, I am, whew, he almost died. Obviously, Jesus kept quiet after that, right? No, let's keep going. Go over real quick just to John chapter 10, verse 7. I love this. Therefore, Jesus said again, very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. In other words, you cannot get into heaven except through me, the gate. Oh, go over to verse 11. I am the good shepherd. And the good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Go over to chapter 11. I love this one too. Verse 25. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? Go over to chapter 14, verse 6. Jesus said, I love this stuff. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through Muhammad? Through me. Go over to chapter 15, verse 5. Jesus said, I am the vine, the true Israel. You are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit for the kingdom. But apart from me, you can do what? Nothing. You see that? Go over to chapter 17. This is Jesus, his high priestly prayer before he was going to be crucified. After Jesus said this, verse 1, he looked toward heaven and prayed, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. For you granted him authority over all people, that he might give eternal life to all those whom you have given. Go down to verse 4. I have brought you glory on earth by finishing the work you gave me. Now watch this. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had when? With you when? Before the world began. Jesus never claimed to be God. Really? We're just reading John's gospel. Do you think Jesus was clearly saying, hello, ego a me, I'm the bread of life, not you, Nicholas, I am. I'm the light of the world, not you, Julie, I am, and no one else is. Gaggy, before Abraham, I am. Robert, I'm the gate, not you. Dr. Leah, I'm the good shepherd, not you. Christina, I am the light of the world, not you. Pavel, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me, not through you. Maya, I'm the life and the resurrection. Whoever believes in me, not you, but in me, will live. Do you believe this? Kelly, I'm the true vine. Apart from me, you can do nothing. Father, restore me to the glory I had with you before the world began. What was Jesus clearly saying? I'm God. Now, this is interesting. Muhammad claimed Jesus was sinless. So here's my question. Was Jesus lying? Or was he telling the truth? Because if Jesus is, get this, I do this with Muslims all the time. Jesus is he always tells the truth, right? Of course he does. Jesus never lied, never. Why would you say that? Because Jesus is sinless, according to the prophet Muhammad. Good, then explain to me what Jesus was saying here. He was either lying or he's Lord. Do you understand what I just said? It's very clear what he said here. He's saying, I'm God. So Muhammad, if Jesus is sinless, that means he doesn't lie. That means he was telling the truth. And therefore, Jesus told something else very clear. Look at verse 3. He tells us what eternal life is. Now, this is eternal life, that they may know you, the one true God. Allah? And Jesus Christ, who is God, God the Son, whom you, God the Father, sent. Do Christians and Muslims worship the same God? No. No. Jesus tells us who the one true living God is. God the Father. And eternal life is not through Muhammad. Eternal life, Jesus says, is that we may know you, God the Father, the one true living God, and Jesus Christ as Messiah and Savior. Amen. Do you understand? Why Jesus? Why not Mary? Mary told us, right? Why Jesus and not Muhammad? Jesus told us who he is, right? And let's just do one more real quick. You want to? Why Jesus and not modern religions? Because all religions lead to heaven, right? All paths lead to the same mountain, right? You've heard that before. Go to Hebrews real quick with me. Hebrews chapter 1. Okay, let me real quick give you a little background on three really popular modern religions so you guys understand. And again, you can just write things down on your notes there, okay? Hebrews chapter 1. All right, here we go. Boom. Buddhism. Do you realize Buddhism is the fourth largest, fastest growing religion in the world? What does Buddhism have to say about Jesus? Guess what? Nothing. Buddha himself did not believe in God, in the existence of God. And Buddha himself clearly claimed, "Hello, everybody, I'm not God." And it's so sad because people worship, Buddhists worship who? Buddha. He's like, "I'm not God." Okay? Now, because of that, Buddhists don't believe in Jesus. They didn't believe he existed. Okay? What they believe is you can, I'm not even sure they believe in this, in salvation. Their form of salvation is called nirvana. The goal of Buddhism is to free yourself from earthly suffering. And how you do that is you have to follow all these steps of Buddhism. It is through human effort and good works that you can eventually, on your own, through your own effort, achieve nirvana. Does that make sense? The key here is they don't believe in Jesus, and they believe it's through their own efforts they can achieve their Buddha-type status. Make sense? Let's go to another religion, Mormonism. We've got a Mormon building right down the street, one of the fastest-growing religions in the world. According to Mormons, who is Jesus? Well, he is a separate God, Bogich, okay? He's not God. He's separate from Elohim, the Father. So he's a lesser, created being. He was created, how? Through sexual union between the Father and the Mother, and there are many different ways they explain it, and he became the big brother to all other spirit beings. So Jesus in Mormonism is not God. He is a created being, a spirit being, some say an angel, whatever. And as a Mormon, the way you get to become your own God, get your own planet, is through your own human effort and good works. Does that make sense? Like Buddhist, no, he's not God. I don't even believe in him. We achieve through our efforts. Mormonism says the same thing. He's not God. He's a created being. you achieve through human effort. Look, Jehovah's Witness. Jehovah's Witnesses clearly say Jesus is not God. He's a lesser. He is a created being. Okay? They believe that he was the first thing that Jehovah created. And again, through their human effort and good works, they can pay for their own sins, Jehovah's Witnesses say. Does that make sense? So the three fastest growing religions in the world all have something in common. Not one of them believe that Jesus is God. And not one of them believe in salvation by grace alone, through faith alone, in Jesus alone. They believe you have to do the work in order to be saved, in order to be accepted by God, whichever God they believe in order to have your sins paid for. Does that make sense? So there's a big difference between Christianity and modern religions. I'll give you an example. Let's see what the Bible has to say. Chapter 1, verse 1, we read, "In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son." Well, sorry, Buddha, but Jesus does exist. "Whom," the Son, "he appointed heir of all things. And through whom," "also he made the universe." Do you guys see that? Fill it in. Jesus is creator, not created. Like the Mormons say and the Jehovah's Witnesses say. "The Son is the radiance of God's glory," meaning that as God, he radiates glory. Just like the Father does, just like the Holy Spirit does, God the Son radiates glory. Remember Jesus said in John 17, "Restore to me the glory I had with you before the foundation of time." Not only that, he's also the exact representation of his being. In other words, God the Son is one in being or essence with the Father and the Holy Spirit, but he's also a separate person. Okay, he is the representation, exact representation. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Okay, watch this. "He sustains all things by his powerful word," fill in the blank. Jesus is sustainer. He is not sustained by anyone or anything. And watch this. "After he had provided purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven." So he, Jesus, became as much superior to whom? The angels, as the name he has inherited is superior to theirs. Fill it in. Jesus is greater than the angels. Thus the angels worship Jesus. In fact, the writer goes on to say, I'm going to read it to you guys. Let's go. Verse 5. To which of the angels did God ever say, "You're my son, today I become your father"? Or again, "I will be his father and he will be my son"? And again, when God brings his firstborn into the world, he says, "Let all God's angels worship him." Talking about God the Son. In speaking of the angels, he says, "He makes his angels spirits and his servants flames of fire." But about the Son, he says, "Your throne, O God." Do you see it? What did God the Father call God the Son? God! "Your throne, O God, will last forever and ever. A scepter of justice will be the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated wickedness. Therefore, God, your God," do you see it? "has set you above your companions by anointing you with the oil of joy." He also says in the beginning, "Lord," do you see what he's calling him there? "You laid the foundations of the earth." Jesus is the creator. "And the heavens are the work of your hands," not of the angels, not of some spirit being, okay? Some false spirit being. "They will remain, but you, they will perish, but you'll remain," because he's eternal. They will all wear out like a garment. You will roll them up like a robe. Like a garment, they will be changed. But you remain the same. Remember, Jesus is the same today, yesterday, and forever. And your years will never end. Because he's God. To which of the angels did God ever say, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet? And oh, by the way, are not all angels ministering spirits sent to serve those who will inherit salvation? What do angels do? They help us. And they worship Jesus. Do you see what modern religion says? Jesus is less. You see what the Bible says? Jesus is Lord. And didn't all the modern religions say something else about salvation? Human effort? Good works? To be saved? Pay for your sins? Be accepted by God? Go to chapter 10 real quick. And then we're going to bring it to a home here. Look at verse 11. I love this. The writer was talking about religion, saying it's crazy, it doesn't work. Why? Day after day, every priest does what? Stands and does what? Performs his religious duties again and again. He offers the same sacrifices, which can never take away sins. But when this priest, referring to Jesus, high priest, had offered for all time, how many sacrifices for sins? One sacrifice for sins. What did he do? He sat down. What does that mean? Job's over. Where human priests, human modern religion, they stand and they do sacrifice, do all their works, their good efforts and this and that. Hello, the writer says, no. They offer the same sacrifices day after day, which can never pay for your sins. But when this priest finished his work, offered one sacrifice, his body, his blood, for all time, he sat down, paid in full, at the right hand of God. And since that time, he waits for his enemies to be made his footstool. For by one sacrifice, he is made perfect forever those who are being made holy. Do you understand what the writer was saying? Religion says you have to do in order to be saved. Christ says it's already been done for you. Trust in him. You see, every religion recognizes there's something wrong with us. That there's a disconnect from God. Every religion understands we have a sin nature. They may call it something else. They may not even try to openly acknowledge it. But every religion understands there's something wrong. Because God has put eternity on our hearts. And as a result, modern religion tries all these other different methods to through human effort and good works to pay for sin to get acceptable before God. The problem is, as the writer of Hebrews has told us, you can offer all kinds of good works day after day. They don't pay for your sins. In fact, they lead us on a highway to hell. But God the Father sent God the Son to this earth. Unlike us, he was born of the Virgin Mary. Conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit. We read that. And is God who was man, the man, Christ Jesus, lived a perfect life, never sinning once. Clearly declared, I am God. And what happened? His enemies put him on a cross, but that was part of the plan. And as Jesus hung there, God the Father in his love for us took our sins, placed them on Jesus, and punished Jesus once for all time. Jesus died, but 3 days later, what happened? He rose from the dead. That means he paid for our sins in full in terms of that day of judgment. And Jesus offers us salvation as a gift. That's why it's called mercy. That's why it's called grace. It's a gift. And we receive the gift by turning away from thinking that we can follow modern religion and its methods of saving ourselves. We say, that's wrong. And we turn in humble repentance and faith to Jesus, ask him to forgive us of our sins, trusting in him and him alone, not Mary, not Muhammad, and not modern religion. And Jesus says, through his once for all sacrifice, you're saved. You can relax. Unless you want to stand all day and day after day after day try to impress God with all your good works. Or maybe you trust in the one, God the Son, who sat down and said, I'm the one who paid for your sins through my good work. It's not Mary. She told us. Not Muhammad. Jesus told us who he is, right? Jesus says, I'm God. It's not modern religion. The writer of Hebrews says, what are you doing? Jesus is not a created being. He's the creator. He's the sustainer. He's the savior. Why Jesus? Because Jesus is the Messiah. How do we know that? Let's go real quick back to Luke chapter 1 where we started. And now we will bring it to a close. Let's read again verses 26 through 35. And let's see if you now understand what was being said here. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. By the way, the Messiah was going to come through the line of King David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you. What does highly favored mean? Full of? She was the recipient of grace, not the dispenser of grace. Do you understand the difference now? Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You are a recipient of grace. You are not the mother of God who dispenses grace. You will conceive and give birth to a son. For unto us a son is born. And he will be called Jesus. What does Jesus mean? Savior. He will be great. He will be called the Son of the Most High. Not a created being, the Creator. One in being with the Father and the Holy Spirit. Co-equal, co-eternal, consubstantial. He will be great. He will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God, Father, will give him, God the Son, the throne of his father David. And he will reign over Jacob's, what was the word descendants I told you? House forever. His kingdom will never end. Watch me. How do we know Jesus is the Messiah? Fill in the blanks. 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 16. God had said to King David, 1,000 years before the birth of Christ, your house, your kingdom will endure forever before me. Your throne will be established forever. Did King David live forever on earth? Is he still sitting on his throne? This was called the Davidic covenant. God was promising through David the Messiah would come. Now you see those words that were written 4,000 years before Christ? Look what the angel had said to Mary. Again, verse 32 and 33. He will be called great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the what? Throne. Look at the word. Throne of his father David. And he will reign over Jacob's what? House. Look at the word. For how long? Forever. And his what? Kingdom will never end. Whoa! So you think maybe the angel didn't make a mistake and say, Mary, you're the one? No, the angel was very clear. No. Not Muhammad. Messiah. Jesus Christ. Whose kingdom, throne, and house will last forever. How will this be, Mary asked. Since I'm a virgin, the angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So, watch me, the Holy One, Messiah, Anointed One, will be born, called Son of God, the Son of God. Do you understand why Jesus and why not Mary? Why Jesus and why not Muhammad? Why Jesus and why not modern religion? Why Jesus? Because he's the promised Messiah. That's why we celebrate his birth. That's why we celebrate his life. That's why we celebrate and worship him. Because he's God, God the Son. Mary didn't want the worship. She said, no, I need a savior. I'm a sinner, I'm a bondslave. Muhammad got it confused. The angel Gabriel shows up to him supposedly 600 years later. No, Muhammad, Jesus is not this created being. He's not some good prophet. He is God, because Jesus said it. I am, I am, I am, I am. Before Abraham was born, I am. He said to the Father, restore to me the glory I had. And modern religion can't save, because modern religion denies the lordship of Christ. Modern religion says you have to do it through your own efforts. Scripture says, go ahead and try it. Priests have tried it all their lives. Day after day, they try. Day after day. They stand, and they offer, and it cannot pay for your sins. You want to try it? Go ahead and try it. Or I got a better idea, the writer says. How about trust in the one, God the Son, who paid once and for all time, for your sins. And the angel Gabriel clearly had said to Mary, let me tell you, Mary, you who are full of grace, the recipient of grace, the one you're going to be carrying, is the one that was promised 1,000 years earlier through David. That through David's house would come one who would sit on David's throne and whose kingdom would last forever. And that's why Mary said, how's this going to happen? God made it happen. That's why we celebrate Jesus, not just on Christmas Day, but every day. And that's why Jesus said, you come to me, not to Mary, not Muhammad, not modern religion. All of you who are weary and burdened, and Jesus says, I will give you what? Take your yoke upon me, Jesus says. Learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Jesus says, for my yoke is easy, my burden is light. All authority in heaven and earth belongs to Jesus the Messiah. If you're tired of being tired, if you're tired of being stressed, if you're tired of following the wrong system, Jesus says, come to me. And he says, I will give you rest. Let's pray. Almighty God, we thank you so much for your word of truth. We thank you, Almighty God, that you would put so clearly in your scriptures the truth about our Messiah. We thank you, Almighty God, that we know that we can know who the Savior of our souls is. That's Jesus Christ. We can know, and not just trust by blind faith, but we have clear statements in your word of truth, God, as to who Jesus is and what he's done for us. And we thank you. And dear Jesus, it is our honor, our privilege to worship you during this season, remembering your birth, rejoicing in your life, remembering also your sacrificial death on our behalf, your resurrection, the life you give to us, the grace you bestow upon us, that we could be forgiven our sins and have life with God forever. God, may we not take this season for granted. May it not simply be a season where we're busy about shopping, busy about traveling, busy about all kinds of other things. May this be a season where we rejoice in who you are, Jesus. May this be a season where we just bow in adoration to you and say like Mary, man, Jesus, you're my Savior. I know I'm a sinner. And Jesus, I want to be your bond slave forever, out of gratitude for the free gift of saving grace. Yet as I say that, I realize there may be some people sitting here or sitting there in South Florida who have never truly trusted you, Jesus, as their Lord and Savior. My friend, if that's you, maybe you've been mixing in a little bit of Mary. Maybe you've been a little confused when it comes to Muhammad. Maybe you have also been following some of the modern religious systems. Hopefully today you understand those all fail. And hopefully today you understand that Jesus is the Messiah. And if you are looking to have forgiveness of your sins, if you're looking to have life with God, life eternal, then that can happen right now. How? You can simply repeat these words after me. You can pray, but do it with an honest heart and mind. You can simply say, dear Jesus, I know who you are. You're God, God the Son. I know who I am. I'm a sinner, and I need a Savior. And Jesus, I believe that 2,000 years ago, you were punished on that cross for my sins. You died the death that I deserve. But 3 days later, you rose from the dead. You paid for my sins in full in terms of that day of judgment. So Jesus, I come to you. I humbly ask you to forgive me of my sins. I humbly ask you for the free gift of eternal life. Please bestow your saving grace upon me. My friend, if you've come to Jesus in that way, if you have trusted in him and him alone, and the Bible says that you are saved and you can rejoice, you're a child of God forever. Worship him. He's your Messiah. Remember, he's the one and only mediator between you and God. Go to him, pray to him, and look to him when you have burdens and stress. For he says, come to me. I will give you rest. Believe that, my friend, because Jesus is the only one qualified to be able to do that. Lord, thank you so much again for encouraging us through your truth. And I pray for each person here, Lord, that as we go forward, we would be worshiping you, Jesus, and you alone. Because we know that by knowing you, we have salvation. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And all of God's people said, amen.